TransLash Media, Imara Jones.
Welcome, everybody. And good evening. Thank you for coming to this Trans Day of Remembrance commemoration and public event here at Samsung. This is a joint effort of my project TransLash and of Samsung as a part of their Samsung Experience series. I want to thank each of you all for coming here tonight because the most valuable thing that we have in our lives is time. It's the only thing that we have. And the fact that everyone here has decided to donate a portion of their finite time to affirm that trans lives, whether or not they are still alive or have passed or are still here, matters, I think is something for all of us to be deeply grateful for, and I know that I am. I want to start off by thanking one of our many, many, many partners. There's no way that a night like this happens and that we get all these people in this room without a variety of partners. As trans, GNC, queer, LGBTQ people, our community functions best when we work collectively. It's the way that we have survived. It is the way that we continue to survive. It was very intentful that we involve community in this event from the beginning. And so it's important that we thank and recognize them for their work. I want to thank the Transgender Law Center and the GSA Network for the work that they both do individually and for their sponsorship of the Our Trans Truth campaign, which is a trans youth leadership program which emphasizes storytelling as a way to ground trans lives in our experience. You will see some of their work later on. It is amazing, and they have added so much to tonight. I want to thank the Anti-Violence Project, on which I am on the board, for their help in promoting tonight's event and also connecting us with the amazing Melania Brown and the family of Laylene Polanco, who is going to give us so many insights tonight. And I am deeply grateful for everyone at AVP for the work that they do to end violence and to end the causes of violence and to help us out tonight. I also am deeply grateful as well for the Global Action Program, specifically Trans Resistance Through Media, who will be providing many of the artwork that you saw behind us as a part of their campaign, but additionally, we'll be adding a lot of art, digital media, et cetera, throughout the program, which you will see throughout on the wall behind me. And I'm deeply grateful for everything that they do for our community as well. And last but not least, I want to thank the people at Samsung and at Samsung Experience and at Samsung 837. Over the past months, and particularly over the past 2 weeks, we have worked and spent probably hundreds of hours together bringing this event to you. I have to say that, of course, when a corporation comes to you and says, "We're here to help," that it can sometimes elucidate some skepticism. But I knew that this was right and this was going to be right when in our first meeting, Michelle Engel, who leads the marketing team here and across the country, who I actually also went to high school with, we were in a meeting together, in our very first meeting, trying to figure out how we were gonna do this and how it was gonna work. And I thought that it was all gonna be about, you know, whiz-bang technology, which it kinda is with this big wall, but it was gonna be about whiz-bang technology, that it was going to be about actually pushing product. And in the middle of the program, when we were going through ideas, I just turned to her at one point and I said, "You guys care more about the people than the technology." And she looked at me and said, "Yes," which is what we're going to do tonight. This is all about the people and not about the technology. So I don't know about you, but I am looking forward to the day when Trans Day of Remembrance becomes a thing of the past. But we are not there yet, which is why we are all here together. it is not yet past. It is still very much present. It is still very much present in our lives. One of the ways in which I realized how present it was is when I interviewed the entire cast of Pose and I asked them what they wanted for a trans future, how they imagined that. These are people on a show which is nominated for many awards, Emmys, has people who have shot to the heights of their profession. And when I asked them what they wanted for a trans future, they almost all said, just to stay alive. So my program and my project is called TransLash. We are a project and a program that create and curate trans stories, because we believe that telling trans stories is a way to tell trans lives. Because the way in which we are subject to the unbelievable violence that we all face is because people don't see us as human. They don't see us as having families. They don't see us as having loved ones. They don't see us as having dreams, and they don't see us as worthy. And the way that we combat that is to show day in, day out, in every way, and every minute that we can, that we are real, and that we matter. Now, TransLash does lots of different things. I urge you all at some point, not now, to go to translash.org to see what all of that is. We actually just relaunched our website today, so it fully will tell you what we're doing in a way that is compelling and interesting, so please make sure that you do that. But the reason why I chose the name is because we're living in a really powerful, excruciatingly powerful in both ways that are positive and negative moment. Right? In one moment, in one way, we have and are experiencing epidemic levels of violence against trans people. And that's not something that I'm saying. I'm not saying that for hyperbole. That's what the American Medical Association said this year, that it's an epidemic of violence. The United States has more trans murders than any other country on the planet except two, and that's Brazil and Mexico. 2018 has seen overall the highest levels of hate murders since most of the people in this room have been alive, since the time of Ronald Reagan, since the 1980s. It's a very excruciating and real moment. And it's no wonder then why people who are famous and at the height of their profession say that all they want to do is to be able to live. But it's also a moment in which we're all here. It's also a moment in which we have tremendous visibility, in which I am standing here with this microphone in this space and we are gathered together. And so we here together are actually the hope. We are the solution to making sure that Trans Day of Remembrance becomes a thing of the past. And so tonight we're going to go on a journey, and we're going to go through lots of different feels. We're going to grieve, we're going to honor, we're going to be sad. We are going to hear from family members who have lost people to anti-trans violence about how that experience is for them. And then we're going to hear from people who are still with us and the challenges that they are facing. And we'll ultimately end up in a place of, I hope, feeling confident, feeling that no matter what the difficulty is that we face, that we are not alone, and that despite what people say, including the current occupant of 1600 Pennsylvania White House, we're not going back, we're not going anywhere. So let me just briefly run you through the program, and then I'll do some housekeeping stuff, and then we're going to be off to the races. First, after I finish this welcome, we're going to hear from the spoken word poetry and artistry of Miss Mojo. She looks amazing. I'm a little sad and upset, but it's okay. She knows she gets to look any way she wants to. we're going to start off with Miss Mojo. Then we're going to move to our commemoration, our reading of the names. And that's going to work a little bit differently. You know, normally when you have a reading of the names, it's a very organized affair. It's like cut glass. It's highly organized and it's highly structured. But when I was talking to Melania, we reminisced about how when we lose people to anti-trans violence, that it's not orderly. It is not comfortable. It is a highly disruptive process. And so we actually want to honor what that experience is like by asking people who want to volunteer to read the names. We need 23 volunteers. So I want you to think about whether or not you want to be a volunteer. And when we call volunteers, you're literally going to have to get up. This space is going to have to adjust. People are going to have to move. It's going to be a little bit uncomfortable. But that's the reality of what happens when we lose people. And we can't pretend, even though we're in a sanitary space, that it's sanitary. After the reading of the names, we're going to have a moment of silence. The lights will go dark. We will ask those of you who wish to turn on the lights of your phones to do that, and then we will be silent and dark for a minute. After that, we're going to liven it up a little bit, not liven it up, but we will lighten it a little bit by having affirmations to remind us that we're still here. And then afterwards, I'm going to talk to Melania about her and her family's experience, and for her to bring her amazing sister in the room. And her sister is amazing because she shared with me family videos of Laylene, and we spent a lot of time talking about her, and we need to hear about her in a way that is beyond the four corners of a press article. And then we're going to finish with two stories of two young people from across the United States. They still call themselves young people, so I'm allowed to. One is Jay Covert, who is a student at Champaign College in Vermont, where they are facing a backlash from college Republicans who are walking around telling people that there are only two genders. And it has caused a huge uproar on their campus. They are involved in pushing back on that, and they're gonna tell us what that story is like, what that experience is like. You know, the backlash is real, it's not esoteric. It's happening where people are, and they're gonna tell us that story. And then we're gonna hear from the amazing Mulani Jackson. And I'm smiling because I've seen her video several times, and I never get bored because she is life. And if anything, that's what's life, that's what being trans is, it's life. So we're gonna end with life. And we're going to end knowing that despite the incredible hardships that we face, that we do have a future because we have a past. So let me go through the normal now housekeeping things that you have to do when you stand up here and you're telling people what to do. So throughout this experience, we want people to use the hashtags, three hashtags. And you have to use them all three, or what I'm going to tell you isn't going to work. I know that's annoying, but that's life. So you have to use TransLash, hashtag TransLash. You have to use hashtag Samsung Experience, and you have to use hashtag TDOR. Now, when you do that, what's going to happen is that your tweets and your comments, your if you decide to draw, if you decide to take a picture, if you decide to take a video, that's all going to go from time to time as we move through the program on this wall. And then at the end, at some point, we're actually going to gather all of those up and create another product. So please make sure that you do that and do that throughout. It's also going to be the way that at the end we have a public conversation by choosing some of the comments that are going to be, that you guys are going to create and generate. This is audience participation. It's going to be the way that we actually end and have a kind of public town hall on various things that you're thinking, questions that you have, answering the question that you guys, many of you guys, did when you were given the Galaxy Note 10 S Pen on how you defy barriers to overcome obstacles. All of that will be the basis in which we conclude this event by hearing from each other. And then certain of you being asked to stand up and tell us why you sent that, and then us taking comments on it. So I just want you all, I will be reminding you from time to time to use Samsung, hashtag Samsung Experience, hashtag TDOR, and hashtag TransLash so that we can make sure that we have a robust comment section to be able to do that with, and you should use Twitter to do that. So I think that that is my last piece of official housekeeping in order to do that. Before I move on, though, I want to just honor, you know, our own individual power. Because the only reason why we're here is because a woman decided in 1999, Gwendolyn Ann Smith, to honor her friend Pam Hester, who had been killed in anti-trans violence in 1999. She just decided to do that. She just decided that the loss of her friend was something that needed to be marked and that we needed to find a way to do that. And now Trans Day of Remembrance is marked in over 200 places around the world. And so one of the things that we have to constantly remember in this moment is that despite the overwhelming nature and the forces that we feel, that we're not powerless. And that the things that we do that may seem small, the fights that we wage, can have big echoes over time. So with that, I want to key up and kick off our program with someone who embodies this notion of individual power and not holding back. That is Miss Mojo. Miss Mojo is a multi, and I do mean multi, talented personality, curator, designer, poet, model, and artist from New York. Like, her family here goes back a lot of generations. It's kind of crazy. She is the creator of the popular underground event Paint and Poetry. She is a New York Fashion Week show producer and runway coach, motivational speaker, writer, and teaching artist for the city of New York. Mojo is an activist for the arts, equality, and love, and now we will bring out the fashionable, the person who stunts with her outfit tonight, Miss Mojo.
Couldn't see this coming down my eyes, so I had to make the sax cry. I couldn't see this coming down my eyes, so I had to make the sax cry. I'm tired of waking each day, not knowing if it's my last. Shaving my face to make sure I pass. I'm tired of training my waist to get me a shape. I'm tired of tucking my love with the stickiest of tape. I'm tired to do of all these things to make sure I'm alive. I couldn't see it come down my eyes, so I had to make the sags cry. See, I'm a fat black trans woman. I'm not supposed to exist with all of this body, these breasts, these hips. How dare she come outside and choose to just live, speak truth to power with gloss on her lips. Being trans is a myth in a world full of cis. And no, I don't mean cis like eco gel and acrylic tips. I mean cisgender. It don't matter where you land, Eva, because the straights give me their hate, but the gays give me their fever. Yeah, we the alphabet gangsters, but I noticed the L, G, and B often align with the oppressor to victimize the T. Now, I don't say it to be mean, and I don't mean to be cruel, but when black trans women are being killed twice a month, what do you do? Do you normalize our spirits, or do you hush your lips in shame? Do you misgender us in death so the families can't be blamed? Do you tell our stories in humanizing form? Or do you touch yourself in private mode while watching TS porn? See, unlike your tabs, trans folk can't be closed. And no matter the resistance, our stories will be told. I had Marsha on my pen when I wrote this piece. I had Sylvia in my mind when I graced the page. Octavia on my lips when it's time to speak. My mama and my movement when I burns my sage. Black trans women are here to stay. We have always been here since the beginning of time. You cannot kill the spirit when the soul is divine. You cannot make ugly a face so damn fine. Does my sexiness upset you? Does it come as a surprise that I dance like I have diamonds between my thighs? See, a black poet named Maya Angelou taught me to still rise. So I will arise above this administration that is curating my demise. We need access to health care. We need access to safe spaces. We need employment opportunity. We need housing. We need people willing to stand up and educate the ignorant so the labor ain't always on us. We need the love of our families. We need lovers in the daytime, even if we don't pass. We need not to be outed whenever you're mad. We need our humanity not to be reduced to sexual intercourse whenever we share our truth. Because at the end of the day, trans people don't transition for you. We're gonna take it to church. Clap for me. Slow it down, y'all. Come on. All right.
Bountiful life and all the loves inside of me. I'll stand as tall as the tallest tree, and I'm thankful for each day that I'm given, those that are good and the hard ones I'm living. But most of all, I'm thankful for loving who I really am. I'm beautiful. I'm beautiful. I'm here.
please make some noise for Ming on the saxophone. My name is Mojo Disco. I love you. 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 Thank you. Thank you.
Let's give it up again for Mojo and for Benjamin. When I first asked her, I called and said, will you do this? She paused and she goes, well, you know, I don't do this for everybody. And I know that we're all glad that she did. Excuse me. So right now, we're going to move into the commemoration portion of our program, where we read the names of those who we have lost to anti-trans violence. Now, historically, Trans Day of Remembrance is for people who have been lost to anti-trans hate violence. But tonight, we're also including people who have been lost to state-induced violence against trans people, because I say that if the leading reason is why you are not here is because you are trans, we need to remember you. And it doesn't really matter. So I want to ask for the volunteers who's willing to read names. If you're willing to read names, just come down here, and this person, Lauren, will make sure that you guys are queued up, excuse me, and will tell you how the process will work. You can come down for way up top if you want to, too. I'll be right back. So each person will come up and read a designated name. Each person will then remain on the stage. As you read the name, do not leave. Just simply organize yourselves on the stage and behind the podium. At the conclusion of the names, as I mentioned, this place will go dark entirely for 60 seconds. If you wish to turn on your lights on your camera phones or other devices, please do so during that time. Again, we'll be dark and silent for 60 seconds. And so now we will begin with the reading of the names.
Dana Martin, and she's 31 years old.
Jocelyn Ware, there's no age.
Ashanti Carmen, 27. Claire Legato, no age.
Alicia Chanel Stanley, 46.
Malaysia Booker, 23.
Michelle Tamika Washington, 40.
Paris Cameron, age 20.
Chanel Lindsay, 26.
Joanna Joa Medina, 25, June 1st, 2019.
Chanel Scarlett, 23.
Leilene Polanco, 27.
Zoe Spears, 23.
Brooklyn Lindsay, 32.
Bubba Walker, 55.
Denali Beres-Starkey, 29.
Tracy Single, 22.
Kiki Fantroy, 21.
B. Love Slater, 23.
Pebbles Ladime Doe, 24.
Bailey Reeves, 17.
Italy Marlowe, 29. Brianna B.B. Hill, 30. With the conclusion of the reading of these names, we will now enter into a moment of silence. This space will go dark for 60 seconds. If you wish, please take out your cell phones and illuminate. We're the light in the darkness. Thank you all. So that was heavy, and it should be. There's no reason it shouldn't be. But whenever we lose people, those of us who are still alive have to figure out how to keep going. We have to figure out what we're going to do next. We have to figure out how to make sure that the person that we lost isn't forgotten. And the only way that we can do that is by continuing to live. And so I want us right now to affirm, actually, our lives. The fact that we are still here. The fact that we are still here together. So I want to do two things. The first is I'm going to ask on the count of three for everyone to take a deep breath in and to breathe out collectively. And the reason why I do that is because when we do that collectively, what we will generate is actually the sound of the ocean. We'll generate the sound of one of the most calming sounds that we as human beings know. And that will help us. And the second thing I want to do is to go through a set of affirmations. Now, this is going to be possibly weird because what I want you to do is to turn to the person next to you and to recite the following, one to the other. We budgeted time. If you don't know the person, do it. Now, the first time that I had to do this, I was Savannah Brown. Is Savannah here? No, she's not here. So she had me do this, a whole group of us do this at a gathering of the Black Women's Blueprint. And an odd thing about me is that even though I'm a public person, I'm actually highly private. So when she turned, when she asked me to turn to a person next to me that I didn't know and to do affirmations, I was freaked out. But I have to say that afterwards, I felt human. And so what we want to do before we move on to the other portions of our program, again, is to reaffirm our humanity. So we're going to do that exercise. But before we do that, I want you to, on the count of three, all take in a deep breath. And not like the one in the doctor's office where you're just trying to get it over. I mean like a real one, right? Like the cold stethoscope, breathe in. You're not breathing in. You're trying to get it over. So I want you to actually take in a really deep breath and then collectively to release it out at the same time. So on the count of one, two, three, everybody take in a deep breath. Okay. One, two, three. And release it loudly. That's the sound of life. The essential thing that we have is our breath. The first thing that we do is breathe. It affirms our life. It's important for us to be connected to that. So the second thing is I want you to read these affirmations. I want you to turn to the person who is next to you. And I want you to say, I see you, I hear you, I believe in you. When you succeed, I succeed, we all succeed. And both of you do it. Don't one person do it and the other person just stay there looking. Because if I see you, I'm gonna make you come up here and do it in front of everybody. Did you do it? Yes. Okay. All right, I think that we've had time to exchange on both sides. What's amazing to me standing up here is that like, actually hearing you all do it, you actually brought life back into the space, right? It actually feels a lot lighter. I have to call out this corner over here just before I move on to the next thing. They're dimming the lights, but this corner right here. So I go to them and they weren't doing it. And so I went to them, I was like, why aren't y'all doing it? And they looked at me and said, we can't understand what you're saying. And I just turned around and pointed at the wall. You know, if you're literate, you don't need to hear. You know, that's the way that works. So right now, I want to ask, where are our chairs? They're coming out? Oh, okay, so you need me to get out of the way is what you're saying? Thank you, Lauren. So Lauren just told me I gotta get out of the way so that we can do the next thing, which is to talk to the amazing Melania Brown. Yeah, so let me get out of the way so we can do that. I'm back. Hey. Hey. Love you too. I'm blinded by the lights. I love you. So I want to ask Melania Brown to come to the stage. She is the sister of Lailene Polanco, who we all know died at Rikers, waiting on bail for $500. And we know that a part of the way that she ended up in jail and the way that she died in jail is because she was trans. And also because we have a carceral state that locks people up for no reason. So, if you sell candy now on the subway, you end up in jail. Churros too. But one of the things that happens, and one of the reasons why I wanted to you to join tonight, and I'm so glad that you did, is because when we die, literally as trans people, what often is reported is our name, how we died, maybe our age, maybe that our gender right, and that's it. They never talked about that there were people who loved us, who were still alive, that we left nieces, that we left coworkers, that we left fellow students, that we were actually real. We rarely actually hear from family members. And so tonight I wanted to just talk to Melania briefly about that experience, to make it real for us and to make it real not only for the people in this room, but the people who are watching. And so Melania does this all the time. She has to do it too often. And so I just want us to give her a big round of applause for her courage, for coming tonight, for being here, for everything that she's had to endure unnecessarily. Is it on? Yeah, it's on.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much for so many reasons. And just how open and generous and loving you are to me, even though we just met 2 weeks ago. And if that's any indication of your sister, then her not being here anymore is a tragic loss for us. And before I ask you a couple of questions, I just want to let you know that most of us in this room, the overwhelming majority, did not know her. But I think I speak for everyone in this room when I say that we grieve for her. And that we grieve for you. And that we wish that you weren't up here. So first of all, I want you to tell us about Lailene. Tell us about your sister. If she were here, what would be some of the things that we would notice about her? And what stands out for you?
Well, she'll be running up and down these stairs because she cannot stay still for nothing. She'll be conversating. She'll probably meet you and say you're her best friend and y'all gonna go hang out after this. That was Lailene. Lailene was, she was a loving person. She just loved anything that breathed. She was loving, she was caring. She would give a person, a complete stranger, her last meal. That was my sister. And this earth needed more of her. But I tried to challenge, you know, channel what I'm feeling, and I like to believe that, you know, the higher power is creating his army. And my sister was too good to be here on this earth. And he needed her more than I did, more than we did.
One of the things that you said about her that I thought really stood out is that when you all were kids, that you would come home and like find random sick or ailing animals in your house because she would like pick them out on the street and bring them to your house. And then you were like, and the older that she got, the animals turned into adults. And then we would randomly have people that we didn't know living for us months on end because your sister was like, come in.
Yeah, so my sister would, she started with animals. I'm talking about any kind. It could be anything. Something that she didn't even know what it was. I will come home and it will be there. And she will try to get me to help her sneak it in the house. My mom caught on. I mean, Laylene's room became a zoo, okay? She had birds in there with sticks on their, what would you call them, on their little feet. Like, you know, she would heal them, and then she would release them back to their home, their habitat. It went from that till one day I come home from school, and now I see a human. And I'm like, oh, hey, and she's introducing me, and she's like, yeah, so are we going to talk to mom about, I'm like, about what? You know, she just needs somewhere to stay. And I'm like, okay, so now we telling the person, whoever it is, you know, this is what you got to do. You got to do this for my mom. If you go wash the dishes, she's gonna say, okay, you can stay. You got to do something. So that's how, then it went from animals to that. My sister would bring in, you know, humans that were rejected from their own family. They had nowhere to go. She would bring them in. They would stay with us for a few months until they get on their feet, and then they go. We went through many faces with Laylene, through many faces. She did what she could. She was just a natural born healer. That's just who she was.
And one of the things that you mentioned that I don't think a lot of people knew is that one reason why it was such a terrible shock, it would always be a terrible shock, but an excruciatingly terrible shock when you got the phone call that she had died, is that you didn't know that she was in Rikers. No one in your family knew. And that she, the way that she operated was that she was the person in your family who always helped everyone else. She didn't want help.
No. Laylene, she never wanted to be a burden on anyone, on friends, on family. She wanted to be the helper. She didn't want no one to help her. She wanted to help others. I remember a week before everything happened, I remember texting my brother. I still have that text. I remember texting him, and I just felt something. I felt something was wrong, and I just call him. I text him, and I'm like, have you heard from Laylene? And he's like, I said, have you heard from Laylene? Is she okay? He's like, everything is fine. Everyone is fine. That's what he said. That was on a Friday. The following Friday, I get the phone call from my brother that my sister had passed. I didn't even know she was arrested. I found out afterwards. Laylene would do things where she was very spontaneous. She would just get up one day and say, you know what, today I'm going to Mexico. So we're thinking, you know, maybe maybe she's in Mexico. She's gonna come with a crazy story like the last time where she told me a shark almost ate her. So I'm like, you know what, she's gonna show up. This is what we're, you know, thinking. My mom found out that Laylene was arrested on Mother's Day. She called my mom and she wished her a happy Mother's Day. She told her she loved her. She told her to take care. It was more like a saying goodbye to her mom. And my mom asked her, she begged her, like, where are you? Like, I want to come see you. My mom is very Spanish, so she don't really understand what they're saying, but if she hears her daughter's name, it's like, okay, I got to stay on the phone. She just didn't want my mom there. She's like, I don't want you here. I'll be home soon. In a couple of more days, I'll be home. We didn't know there was a bell. We didn't know she was in Rikers. We didn't know any of this until after when the correctional officers went to my mom's house. We didn't know anything. Because if I would have known that my sister was there, she would have been here today. She would have not been around my neck in a necklace. She would have been here physically. But my sister was very independent. That's just who she was. She just didn't want anyone to help her. She just wanted to help everyone else.
Your mom is actually on the cover of Out magazine today, which is important. When in the aftermath of her passing, what has been the impact on your family?
I'm sorry.
No, don't apologize.
Everything changed. Laylene was she was, you know, right now she would have a Christmas hat on. She'll be bringing us trees to put up. She was just, she made us whole. She completed us. And now I can't even go to my mom's house. I go in front of her house and I don't want to go upstairs sometimes because my sister is not there no more physically. She's sitting in an urn. We used to all just go to my mom's house on the weekend and just, you know, bother my mom, cuddle with her, drive her nuts to the point. Twerk. Yeah, we did a lot of twerking.
They did, I saw it.
That was our thing. Me and Lilene twerked all over the place. I mean, we would sit there and I'm like, is it moving? And she's like, a little bit. my mom's home is not, it doesn't feel very warm anymore to at least me, to us. Solomon, my brother, he took on 3 jobs just to stay busy and not have to be there. My mom, one of her friends offered her to go work, so she just don't stay in the house by herself. I was very angry. I had all type of thoughts going through my head of what I wanted to do to those that harmed my sister. But then I had to channel it, because I'm not like them. And my sister wouldn't want that. So I had to use that, my anger, because I'm so angry that I haven't even grieved properly. And I'm still trying to learn how to release, to exhale. So I'm learning to channel it and, you know, to save many others, to get her story spread. I give more hugs. I was never a huggy person. That was all Aileen, but I'm learning to give more hugs. I actually love hugging people, complete strangers like her. She loved that too. We're just all went our separate ways. It has not been the same. We haven't even put up a Christmas tree. We haven't spoken about Thanksgiving. We don't feel complete. They broke us. They broke us. And the only way we are healing and the only thing that helps us cope is reaching other lives, you know, being there for others and just bringing awareness, because it has to end. It has to stop. One way or the other, it has to stop. And I believe if we all come together as a team and stop killing one another, we're fighting each other and we're not even the real enemy. The enemy put us against one another to fight each other. And I believe that my daughter's here. I raised my kids to be very open-minded. I believe that racism, hate, criticism is all taught at home. Nobody is born programmed to hate and harm others. That's all taught at home.
One of the ways that you have responded is that your family is currently suing the city of New York. So, and when I asked you about it, we're doing it because we want things to change, not because we care about the money. So I want to hear from you the state of the lawsuit, a little bit more about why you're doing it, and what are some of the ways in which the people in this space can support you and your family as you move through this process of both fighting and grieving?
As you all know, when my sister passed away, we was in the dark for 2 months. They didn't let us know anything. We didn't know anything. We was just sitting home, driving ourselves crazy. What happened? How did it happen? Did she suffer? Did she call out for us? Did she call out for her mom? Because that's what she usually do when she's in pain. She runs to her mom. So we're doing it, we want answers. And the government doesn't move unless there's a lawsuit. The government doesn't do anything unless we make noise. If we stay quiet, nothing happens. So this is the reason why we are suing, because we want answers. And we want everyone that has something to do with my sister's death to be held accountable for their actions. It's not okay that they get to go home and be with their loved ones and they left us empty. I'm not okay with that. It's not okay that right now they're sitting at a dinner table or even watching a movie with their loved ones and we're like this. So that's one of the main reasons. It is the only reason we went on with this lawsuit, because, oh, they got to pay. And they're going to pay.
And one thing that I want to say before I want to hear from you about how we can support you, but I want to just point out just the depth of depravity on Rikers. And what one of the things that you told me is that when you guys finally were able to go through the legal maneuvers and to get the video of the aftermath of her passing, that the guards were cavalier. After they found her dead, they were cavalier, they were laughing, it was literally like another day at the office.
Yes. It was like it wasn't a human laying in there. Like, she didn't have family, like she didn't have loved ones, nieces, friends. They, even after, before they found out, you know, that she was gone, they was just sitting in the front laughing, like nothing. There's no audio, so I'm assuming that my sister was catching a seizure, and they thought that, you know, she was maybe faking it to try to get out of there, or whatever the case may be, they watched her die, and they laughed. And even after they found out that she had passed, they continued to laugh. It made me so angry. Like, I literally when I left from there, go lock myself in a room and just pray to my sister to continue to guide me in the right directions. Cause when I tell you, I was ready to go off. I have to continue to channel my anger into doing positive things and saving other lives. And that's what's gonna bring us peace.
So what can we do to help you? What do people need to do to be able to support you?
Get along. Be there for one another. That's support. Be there. Let's be a team. Let's not fight each other. We're not the real enemy. The government is. Okay? They program us to think that certain things are not okay. Who are they to tell us what to do with our bodies? This is my home that the higher power gave to me. And I will do as I please with it. And no one ever could tell you guys what to do with your body, what to do, how to love, who to love. Love has no face. Love is love. And you guys continuing to do things like this and, you know, just being there and coming to rallies and just, you know, a lot of people reach out and they show, you know, they send their loves and just all that. We just gotta come together. And that's support enough.
One of the reasons why you said you wanted to come tonight was to be an example for your daughter Isis, that you are fighting, and to show how to stand up for herself and to make her proud. I'm confident that I speak for everybody in here that I am sure that she's very proud of you.
Thank you.
Isis, do you want to stand up for just a minute and just wave to everybody with your cute little shirt? Turn around so they can see your shirt. Turn around your shirt. Well, it's okay.
It says, trust no one.
Teach them early, teach them early.
That's it.
Thanks to Eliel from AVP for connecting us.
Yes, absolutely.
And thank you so much for coming, and thank you so much for your bravery.
Thank you for having me, allowing me to continue to spread the story.
So right now we're going to move to two videos of people from across the country. The first is Jay Covert, who I mentioned is non-binary and gender non-conforming at Champlain College in Vermont and is facing a backlash there. And so one of the things we asked them to do, they got fancy new phones from Samsung, and what they were supposed to do with those phones was to record their story about the way in which technology helped or hurt their ability to become who they are, who we are. And so Jay's story is gonna come first, and they're gonna talk about the challenges of the way in which digital and social media can be a headwind, cause difficulty for those of us who are trans and gender nonconforming. And then we'll move on to Mulani, who is the exact opposite. I want to remind you again to use the hashtags TDOR, Samsung Experience, and TransLash to tweet out your thoughts, your reactions, your comments, so that we can feed those into the wall behind me. Please do that so that we can funnel you into the conversation. After we see each of their videos, they've actually tweeted, or they're supposed to tweet, let's see, they took my watch, but they're supposed to have tweeted their reactions because they weren't able to be here tonight, but they are watching live through the live stream. So we'll also hear from them immediately afterwards. So let's now watch the video of Jay Covert. Both of them, I should say, and remind everyone that they are a part of the National Trans Youth Council of Our Truth campaign, which is a joint effort of the Transgender Law Center and GSA Network.
Growing up, I only saw trans women in media, and I never saw the idea that you can exist outside of a binary state. And then I finally saw the identity of being trans and non-binary. My identity clicked in my mind, and I could see being non-binary as something that would make sense for me, as being something that would make me happier. I identify as queer in my sexuality, and I identify as non-binary and genderqueer in my gender. I want to be confusing in a way that gets at the spectrum of identities that people can hold. My name is Jay Covert, and I use they, them pronouns. I am a student at Champlain College in Burlington, Vermont. I am studying psychology and secondary teacher education, with a minor in social justice.
Just coming back from another day at Edmonds Middle School, where I'm helping mentor a group of LGBTQ students during lunch.
Today, we had a 3-hour community dialogue and listening session in response to the Republican Club advertising their event, Change My Mind, There Are Only Two Genders.
Unfortunately, a few strokes of multicolored paint on concrete isn't enough for marginalized students to feel seen, validated, and supported.
Students felt unsafe, disrespected by the tabling and by the administration for allowing this to happen. Champlain College specifically recognized that words used at the Republican Club's tabling can foster violence and suicide attempts and suicide completions by trans and non-binary people every single year. However, it somehow does not violate any discrimination policies and does not violate standards of conduct. It didn't feel like our voices were actually being taken to heart. In a way of saying, well, your pain exists, but it's not painful enough for us to do anything about it. There's a lot of difficulty that comes with social media, with any kind of media response. It's a difficult time for me to be able to navigate Facebook. A lot of us had social media developed before we discovered our trans identity. As much as I want to be able to change my name on Facebook, be able to add my actual pronouns publicly, I can't do that because of the safety risks. Your identity is shared so publicly, so widely. Being someone who's so forefront in my activism, both on campus and in community, I'm going to have to deal with public comments and have to see them. It's not something that I should have to see.
Today is the first day of snow touchdown.
And I have to keep myself preserved enough to get through all of the work that still needs to be done, even after reading dozens and dozens of comments of hate, to try to make my community and my identity feel respected.
Life expectancy is still 35, which quite frankly is tragic. And I don't know about you, but I plan on being 90, okay? Special shout out to Cat Black, Mojo Disco, Imara Jones, Nina Simone Toussaint, Janet Mock, Laverne Cox, currently reigning queens that are doing a lot of good work in the community. People give them their flowers and their roses while they're alive. And thank you to Samsung. This camera is so popping. Anyway, thank you for giving me a platform right now to share my voice, to speak my truth, to see how everyday trans women, what a 9-to-5 is doing. Hey everybody, I'm in my back work room. This is our pride flag that we have back here. Coming to work is a little easier because of that. Online is so great because like, all these different media outlets have been really helping me in my transition. Like YouTube, how to do my hair, how to dress, how to tuck, how to do makeup, my taxes, where to go, what's safe to go, especially these online groups on Facebook, lets me know which places are trans friendly. So now I know a hair salon that I can go to. I've been looking at Talkspace. It's like an online therapy to licensed therapist. Literally phone calls and texting, like whoever like is on the go, which I need because I'm never like having time. Social media has been a lifesaver for me. This fall, I decided to go with a lot of burgundies and nudes and army greens because, you know, it complements my skin tone. I didn't feel comfortable shopping in the women's section. So I'm just so thankful for like the online shopping. I look good right here. How about, okay. And then I have me on some black and blue Air Forces. Okay, so this is my look for today. I just got done my laser appointment. I should not be in the sun. I look greasy, it's the aloe gel. Just gotta feel more comfortable and aesthetically pleasing. I don't know, it's the best area where I live in. It's just more safer for me to do that. I have concealer, blush, and a little bit of bronzer. And obviously my eyebrows. It just gives you a little ooh. So yeah. I see the only people with really good jaw lines can take photos, but I'm here. Taking my photos from the bottles. I'm feeling my oats today. Thank you to online media outlets for giving these queer folks platforms, giving these black folks platforms, people of color platforms. Thank you.
Yeah.
Somebody give her a show. She's amazing. They're both amazing and both show the challenges of the stuff that we have, the things that we have in our pockets, how for one person it is making their life much more difficult as an activist, having to read hate and try to fight for their lives on their college campus, and another person who's learned to do their taxes from social media and to be more of themselves. And that really is the time that we live in. That really is the transgender backlash, those two videos right there. So we are coming to the end of our program. What we want to do at this particular point is to take a little, that's me. I'm looking behind because I'm looking behind for the actual tweets. To take some of your comments that you have sent to us electronically, and then to ask some of you if you want to just tell us a little bit more about why you sent what you sent and what you're thinking. So I just click, are you guys queuing up the first one or do I just click the first one? Okay, they're gonna queue it up. Let's see here. This is from Chinyere. I am working with trans activists experiencing homelessness to ensure that no one in the TGN community is. Let's see if there's a continuation. If that's it, we have to hear from Chinyere because I don't know what the is. So we have a microphone runner somewhere. Do you want to complete your thought for us?
Thank you, Imara, the incomparable Imara Jones, y'all. I'm very glad to just briefly give a shout out. I'm an attorney at the Center for Constitutional Rights, and we're working with trans community activists to ensure that folks experiencing homelessness are able to secure safe shelter. So I'm here, I'm queer, you can holler at me if this is something that you either experience yourself or know folks who can help us try to improve the shelter system for folks who are TGNC or have disabilities. And I cede the floor back to the queen. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Oh, you guys put it here now, okay.
Real time. Thank you for giving me my platform to share my voice, to speak my truth, and to share what an everyday trans woman is doing 9 to 5. That is Mulani Banks. Remember her name. Eugenia Harvey is an eye-opening, heart-opening, and mind-opening. I'm so glad to share this with Imara Jones. Thank you, Eugenia. Eugenia has a unique role in TransLash. She actually is the person that convinced me to do it and lobbied hard despite my resistance. So we should all give her a big round of applause. We wouldn't be here without her. Hey. She also continues to consult and on this project and to tell us when we're doing wrong. Okay. she is a guiding hand. Affirmations for today, every day and everybody, thank you. Thank you for creating this space. Thank you for creating this space. This space, it was empty all day until you made it into something, so thank you all for coming. As a Jewish Israeli, somber ceremonies of remembrance are built into my consciousness. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you for that. I thought this was gonna be more of you guys like telling us stuff, but it's more of you guys being really nice, so thank you. And that is from, Daria, somewhere in here. Before we wrap up, I just wanna know if there is someone live in real time who has something burning that you wanna say, burning that you wanna share. If you do, that probably means you need to tell us because it's coming to you to share. If it is not, who does? Ian.
Support our resilience, not just our remembrance. You can donate to organizations like TransLash or the Ochre Project or Black Trans Travel Fund or Marsha P. Johnson Institute or any of the, or you could also hire people like Mojo Disco. You can hire folks like Devin Norell to write for you. You can hire actors, you can hire performers. Make sure that you're paying the folks who are doing the work, like the incredible Imara.
Thank you. Normally, as queer people, we can go right up here. Normally, as queer people, and then we'll take one more after that, just one more. But normally after this, as queer people, you know, we get recognition on certain days of the year when we need recognition 365 days a year. Yeah.
Yes, also, I would like to give a special shout out to a very special organization called Princess Janae Place. They help transgender individuals find housing and secure health care and also secure employment also. They are located in the Bronx or Queens, I believe, but they do have a website. You might want to look them up on maybe Facebook or Twitter. Princess Janae Place here in New York City. Yes, thank you.
Thank you. You're coming to, okay. So we actually have time on this little clock. So we'll go one, two, three. We'll go one, oh, Mojo, and then you, Dan. Okay.
What's popping, y'all?
You're popping.
Oh, get into the glam. Come on, pan that back. Pan that back, yes. Oh, it's good. All right, I just wanted to speak because you hit me up to do this. And I want to show everyone that I come here humbly. This is not a bragging right. This is a life choice that people are making. We use social media for so much good, but some people use it for so much bad. And to see Imara, my sister, level up this way. Come on, y'all, look at this face. In a time where people are labeling trans folk as magicians, as the great trickers of the world, we are standing here before you, honest, truthful, in our wholeness. We've brought together people from all over here tonight to celebrate us. My mom is here tonight, okay? And we come straight from Southside Jamaica, Queens. So this moment right here, this moment is so humbling for me because we're still working on our relationship. You know, trans issues is not just getting your hair and nails done. Trans issues is losing family and regaining family and people learning to love you in your new form and your new identity and people choosing, because it is a choice, to stop the ignorance in this community. So thank you for this platform. I love you much.
Thank you. I love you too. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Daniel and then Alethea.
Thanks so much, Imara. I just wanted to say that, well, number one, you're great, and this was wonderful, and I'm glad that I was able to be here. But I wanted to say, and it was in part your interview with Laylene's sister that made me think of this, which is the discussion about government accountability. As folks may know, GENDA passed in New York State and was signed into law by the governor earlier this year.
Explain what GENDA is.
It's the, essentially, it adds trans and gender non-conforming people to the New York State civil rights law that says you have a right to be treated with respect and dignity and without discrimination for housing, for employment, for health care, you know, right down the list, right? Public accommodations, education. And I think, you know, when I think about government accountability, we should hold our government accountable to that promise, that we should do everything we can to make gender real in the world. And that people know what GENDA is and know what their rights are, and they exercise those rights every day.
You're right here. Yes, you. I know you are not shy, so don't start right now.
I'm introverted. All right, so I wrote this, like,
Okay, I'm gonna be real honest. Like, it was after a shroom trip, so, you know, like.
we do not condone drugs.
Yeah, we don't, but.
In this venue.
But it was very, how do I explain it? Very, I was just tired of being shitted on, you know? I'm really tired of that. And I hope that, like, while you read this, you read the, especially if you're a gender variant person, that you read it for yourself, you know, like to yourself, like, and for it to be for you. Okay. So this is my first time reading this, by the way. Second, actually. Yesterday was the first time. So the Soviet-made game of Tetris taught me that when you try to fit in, you disappear. Gender variant person consistently met with cis oblivious fear. Extraterrestri visiting from Nibiru. Y'all know we exist in a limbo. Feminine version of Jimbo, yeah, neutron with a giant cerebrum encased in a fabulous cranium. Come embark on this Mayan's quest to find Zion as we find ways to become stronger than titanium. TGNCs start off as a fawn and magically convert into a majestic swan, only to become a fearless Shion. Taoist philosophy describes Shions as spiritually immortal, transcending superhumans, celestial entities ascending past serenity through our collective identities. Trans Danny Phantom up in this bitch, going from portal to portal to educate you mortals. And yeah, it's true, man. We met a mutant humans. And no, I ain't your fucking tranny. You sissies can tokenize. We ain't a taboo. We been here and queer. It ain't okay. I'm almost done. I'm so, actually, this is kind of long. Okay. It ain't okay to fraternize with us one-on-one, and then when it comes down to us, you try to patronize us and try to send us in front of your cis friends. Ashamed that you fantasize about us behind shut doors, and when you get flustered with deep feelings for us, you drop us on the floor and step all over our poor, disenfranchised bodies. Insecure little boys and men bodies acting like birds, you really the hen. Stop being prissy sissies and let cis and trans women fit the role of being a missy. A message to the transphobic dismissies. It ain't okay to be a pygmy and poke and dissect our gender with the very men who do the same to you. You should be ashamed. Compromising our safeties when you add us to your boys. Just an FYI, most of the time they know. We're just treated like toys. You treat trans women experiences as a fragment. And it ain't our fault that your insecurities remain stagnant. We ain't insects that you perceive to be a defect. Collectively, transphobic men and women infect us with this notion that there's this agenda. One that we ain't even receive a memo for. As I try to adore y'all and remain patient, I can feel the pain of our collective ancestors crying in shame at how you project ostracism onto us and deflect your criticism. As you remain oblivious that colonizers instated imperial binary, declaring that there are only two genders, burning and erasing the gray and the gay area in fucking flares. And to you transphobic trans people who internalized all of the pain of colonialism and externalized it onto other visible gender variant people, I wish you the ability to reveal so that you may heal, as the billionaire from Marcy says, and do better rather than trying to be in the good graces in front of transphobic cis faces who only accept a fragment of you, except your genitals, as you metaphorically ingest fentanyl for their limited acceptance. Everyone, learn your history before it remains a mystery. Much love and growth. Here's to an accepting approach to those we may not share a similar experience with. Stay light. Stay lit, bright lights. Love y'all. Thank you.
So poetry created on shrooms seems as good a place to end as any. Hey. Do you all feel better than when you came in tonight? Which means that even in the pain, even in the darkness, that we have hope, we have power, we have the ability. Everybody in this room deserves a future. Everybody in this room deserves hope. Everybody in this room deserves love. Everybody in this room deserves to have whatever is inside of them come out in the best way possible. That's why we're not going anywhere. That's why we're gonna be here. That's why we're gonna live. That's why we're gonna create. That's why we're gonna tell our stories. And that's why we're gonna survive and have joy. Yes. So everyone feels better. Now you see why I believe that telling stories saves trans lives. It's the reason why I get up every day. It's why I'm gonna keep getting up every day to do that, because I really believe that it is essential for us to live. So keep telling your stories. Thank you all for coming tonight so much. Keep everybody that we lost in your heart. Remember them, pay tribute to them by living. Support trans organizations, support trans people, hire trans people. Fight for trans housing, education, artists, and get home safe. Like Melania said, love each other. Thank you all so much.